Okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody. So what I'm going to speak about today is some of the work we've done looking at modified protein within mitochondria in the course of aging, cellular senescence, and we touch upon also oxidative stress situations. So just to bring up the picture of protein modification, the modification we've been looking at are obviously oxidation. So oxidation can affect almost all amino acids, some of them being more sensitive than others to oxidation, namely cysteine and methionine. And there are other amino acids that are giving rise to the formation of carbonyl, so the famous carbonyl we've already heard about today. And this carbonyl is taken as a signature of oxidation of protein. But on top of that, there are many other modifications, and I'm not going to review all these kind of modifications, and mainly irreversible modification. So one of those is modification by lipid peroxidation products, such as HNE and malondialdehyde, that give rise to the formation of adducts on amino acid. And some, in some instances, you can even bring in some carbonyl, namely when HNE is reacting by its double bond, it will bring in a carbonyl. So carbonyl can arise from direct oxidation of amino acid, but also can be brought in proteins by formation of adducts. So another documented modification that do accumulate with age is glycation and glycoxidation. So just to summarize that, so I've been putting here that lysine and arginine are the most targeted amino acid for this modification, ending up in the formation of the so-called advanced glycated end products, just as carboxymethylysine and pantosidine. So on the next slide, it's just to show you that during the course of aging, as we've heard from Kelvin already, there are some problems with maintenance systems, such as protein degradation systems, namely the proteasome and the lone protease, which are taking care of those oxidized proteins by eliminating them. But there are some issues for repairs that I won't have time to address. This is something we're interested in as well. So the famous methionine sulfoxide reductase system that can bring back the oxidized protein when methionine is being oxidized to the native protein. So it's a true repair enzyme because it can work on proteins, methionine that are sitting on proteins, and to bring back cysteine oxidation, thyridoxine and thyridoxine reductase are very important too. So as you can see here, those oxidation, glycation, glycoxidation, conjugation with lipid peroxidation product have well documented to increase with age those modifications. And this actually was reported for a long time, and I put this picture that came from the Stadman lab together with Rod Levine. So they brought up this seeing that in the course of aging, there is an accumulation of those carbonylated protein that is shown here. But if you look carefully at the curve, what you observe indeed is that there is an increase in the second part of the life, whatever it's human, rat, or fly tissue, but it's been shown in other model systems as well, model organism. And the increase that you would expect is just a twofold increase, which might not be so important if you assume that the damage is diluted on the proteome. But it's not the case, obviously, since there are some proteins that do accumulate, specific proteins that do accumulate as oxidized, glycoxidized, or modified by lipid peroxidation product. And this is those proteins that we've been chasing in the past few years, and I'm going to report what we found around this topic. So what we use first is an in vitro model for studying cellular aging, which is based on the replicative senescence. So when cells are young, they divide until they reach a state which is named as cellular senescence. So the cells are old, they don't divide anymore, and they have a different morphology. So here I'm referring to fibroblasts. And they are considered as a good model for studying aging in vitro, aged cell in vitro. So there are different markers, such as beta-galactosidase and increase of P21 and P, 16 that are inhibitor of the cell cycles that are going up and that are characterizing those kind of senescent cells. So what we've been doing here is looking, okay, so this is the markers I was referring to. So our cells that we brought in senescence, they're really senescent. And on top of that, as said previously, the proteasome is indeed declining in these senescent cells. The activity of the proteasome is declining in these senescent cells. So what we've been doing is to look at our favorite modifications that have been introduced before. So there are many others. As we heard from Michael Murphy, the nitrosylation is an important modification as well. But what we've been looking here is that carbonyl formation, formation of lipid peroxidation product, and formation of glycoxidation and advanced glycated end product. So we run 2D gels approach to identify those modified proteins. And as an example, I'm showing you here the experiment we've been doing using those 2D gels. So here is the silver stain for young cells and the silver stain for senescent cells. And you can see here that already in the young cell, you can pick up some proteins that are already modified by HNE, for instance, or glycoxidized, as you can see here. But there is a little more and more intense spots that you can evidence in senescent cell. And those are the spots that we've been identifying in order to find what are those proteins that are readily accumulating as modified in the course of cellular senescence. So this is the list of proteins. So there are some that are heavily modified, such as the cytoskeletal proteins, as vimentin and actin and tubulin. But there are proteins that are involved in protein synthesis, protein transport, energy metabolism, chaperon, and also aldehyde detoxification. So it seems that the proteins that are being targeted are involved in different pathways, and cytoskeleton and protein metabolism are some of those. Energy metabolism is pretty important as well. So looking at those proteins that were found as accumulating as glycated or glycoxidized, so we found proteins that are involved in the cytoskeleton, protein transport, protein synthesis. There were some chaperones being modified, involved in protein degradation, and also involved in energy metabolism. So we've also been looking at those proteins that are increasingly carbonylated in this cellular model of aging. And as you can see here, there is quite a few proteins that are increasingly carbonylated, as evidence on this 2D gel, comparative 2D gels, after Western blotting and the immunodetection with the oxyblot. So you have to derivatize the protein first with DNPH to produce those DNP adducts, and then you come with an antibody which is recognizing this adduct. And the summary of this is shown here. So we evidence a few proteins that were actually increasingly modified in senescent cells. And those proteins, they're either involved in protein maturation, protein degradation, cytoskeleton again, and energy metabolism. So as a summary of that, what we found from this study, because we found in several instances that the same protein was modified not only by carbonylation, but also by HNE modification or HGE formation, and that 37 proteins showed up. And those proteins were mainly involved in energy metabolism, protein maintenance, and cytoskeleton. One of the most interesting things was the repartition of this, the localization of those proteins, the origin of this protein. And it came at a surprise at first that almost half of the proteins were coming from the mitochondria, which means that those mitochondrial proteins, they're really at risk, and they do accumulate as modified in those senescent fibroblasts. So then they were, because you would expect in this cell type that only 10-15% of the proteins would originate from mitochondria. So after that, you have cytosolic protein, proteins coming from the cytoskeleton, ER, nucleus, quite a limited number, and some extracellular as well. So what we've been doing after that was to do a search in the literature on the proteins that were reported as increasingly carbonylated in the during real aging and in the course of age-related disease. So we run the search to look at those proteins increasingly carbonylated, modified by AGE or HNE. We took the protein identified in human, but also in mammalian model of disease, such as rodents. And we ended up finding a total of 183 proteins that we picked out from 42 references. And the result of this survey was that most of the protein belong from the brain, because there have been many studies addressing this issue in the brain. So looking at the status of protein carbonylation in such neuronal disease like ALS, AD, PD, and HD. And at the end, what we found that several proteins were identified consistently in different organ systems, not only brain, but also in fibroblasts and liver and other things like that. And that gave to the conclusion that at least part of the spectrum of protein targeted by those modifications may be conserved and found in different organ systems in the course of aging of age-related disease. So just to summarize here, so this is the cartoon I showed you before for senescent fibroblast, and this is what we found when we analyzed those proteins coming up from the database. And interestingly enough, there's still quite a big number of proteins coming out from mitochondria, a little more from cytosol as compared as what we observe with fibroblasts. And talking about the function those proteins are being involved, so they were, of course, the p-value is a bit smaller for the fibroblast study because there's less protein in that, but the threshold is being obtained for proteins that are involved in carbohydrate metabolism, energy production, free radical scavenging, lipid metabolism, protein synthesis, folding, etc., etc. So what we believe is that those proteins that are being affected, they may actually affect those pathways that they're being involved in. So one other studies that we've been conducting was to look directly at those proteins in a model like an aging rat. So we've been purifying mitochondria from rat liver, looking at a specific modification, glycation, glycoxidation, and we had previously reported that among the proteins that are being targeted by this modification, there are actually glutamate dehydrogenase and catalase. So we went on a proteomic approach to find out what were the other proteins that could be modified by glycation in this model. So we've been comparing mitochondria purified from the liver of old versus young rats. And what we found here, that there is a bunch of protein here that are being modified and found increasingly modified with age coming out from the mitochondria. And here is shown those proteins that are differentially expressed, that are in blue, so I won't have time to give you the list, because what we were more interested here was those proteins that were increasingly glycated, and there are actually very few of them that are overexpressed or underexpressed. They're really coming up alone as modified, as you can see here, very few overlap between those two series of proteins. And just to summarize here what the protein we've been finding that are readily increasingly glycated, glycoxidized during aging in the mitochondria taken out from rat liver, are proteins that are involved in ROS and aldehyde detoxification, proteins that are involved in TCA and urea cycles, fatty acid metabolism was being eaten, and amino acid metabolism as well. So just to introduce a new system that we've been looking at afterwards, being tired of looking only at fibroblasts, so we looked at some more fancy model like these human muscle progenitors or satellite cells, which are key players in muscle regeneration. So those cells, they're very important when there is an injury of the muscle because they can reconstruct the muscle, but they do age, and they do age in vivo, and they do age in vitro as well. So we've been looking at those purified myoblasts when they're young and when they're senescent. And when they actually, when those cells are being senescent, they lose the their differentiation capacity, since when you induce the formation of muscle fiber out of these muscle progenitor cells, you get quite a good number of fibers, but those fibers have much less nuclei than you observe when you do that with young cells, when you induce differentiation. Also, when those cells are being treated with an acute oxidative stress, what you see here is that they lose their proliferative capacity. So they're obviously quite sensitive to oxidative stress as well. So we've been growing those cells in vitro. So having the young cells here and the senescent cells that have used up all their proliferative capacity. And this is a P16-driven mechanism, since P16 is increasing a lot in this system. And what we also found is that the proteasome activity, whatever we were looking at, chemotrypsin-like activity, trypsin-like activity of caspase-like activity of the proteasome, was actually decreasing, but we could not see any decline of the expression of the subunit, which means that the inactivation cannot be explained simply by a decline of proteasome catalytic subunit expression. So it's a more complicated mechanism, most likely some kind of inhibition going on or some inactivation of the proteasome that we've not solved out yet. So we've also been looking at the pattern of proteins that are increasingly modified in this system, in this other system of cellular senescence. So looking at carbonyl, so there is an increase upon, with population doubling. Same is true for the appearance of advanced glycated end product, and same is true with formation of lipid peroxidation adduct. So we use the same kind of technique I was reporting before, quite long techniques, because you have to process your cellular extract, do the separation on 2D gels, and go to 2D Western blot, looking either at carbonyl after derivatization with the NPH, looking at AGE conjugate and AGE formation, looking at that with appropriate antibodies. And at the end, we've been able to identify several proteins that showed an increased modification level with cellular senescence. So they are shown here, so you have the comparison in for each modification we've been looking at. And just to summarize that, so what we found in this cell type is that we didn't have that much mitochondrial protein being modified. Most of them were coming out from cytosol. But they were still involved in such functional pathway like carbohydrate metabolism, cell morphology, cellular assembly, cellular function and maintenance, growth and proliferation, cell death, migration, and protein degradation. And actually, those proteins are listed here. So those that are carbonylated, HNE modified, RGE modified, and you see that there is some kind of overlap, some proteins being modified in different ways. So what we found interesting is that there were quite a few of these proteins that were laying in the glycolytic pathway. So I'm just showing you that here. So all these proteins have something to do with the glycolysis. And what we've been doing afterwards was to try to see whether this those modified proteins that you can see here that showed up as carbonylated, glycated, or HNE modified would get some impact would impact the function. So to address this problem, we've been running some metabolome analysis. And just to summarize and to show you a few of these examples, so we did see actually a decline in G6P, a decline in fructose 6P, and also a big decline of this mixture of one fructose 1,6-D phosphate or glucose 1,6-D phosphate or 1,3-D phosphate because they appear as the same on mass spec and as it's been shown. So we did see a slight decrease of acetyl-CoA, a big increase is pyrophosphate, and also some changes in the NADH-NAD plus ratio, which means that this modification may actually be impairing the glycolytic pathway. And we've done more experiments looking at metabolic flow analysis, and we had a decline of 40% of the glycolytic flow in those old cells as compared to the young cells. So just to be very quick, because I have just 3 minutes left, so we had done previously such an analysis trying to setting up our 2D oxyblot and 2D dyge analysis on fibroblasts that were on myoblasts, sorry, but that's an immortalized cell line of myoblast, which has been treated by acute oxidative stress, namely hydrogen peroxide. And what we took the cells so that the viability won't be that bad. There's still a significant increase in carbonyl, and the activity of proteasome is being impaired upon this treatment. So we've been looking at those proteins that were up or down regulated first using the 2D dyge technology. And we found enzyme involved in antioxidant response, which is not surprising, energy metabolism, protein maturation, and protein degradation. So looking at those proteins that were increasingly modified, increasingly carbonylated in this case, so we found proteins involved in protein synthesis, protein transport, protein maturation, cytoskeletal, again, protein degradation, and energy metabolism. And just to pick on some network analysis that we've been doing with those proteins, the nodes for those proteins that are increasingly carbonylated ended up on Huntingtin, which is quite an interesting protein, while the node of the proteins that were differentially expressed was TP53. So indicating that those proteins that are either under or overexpressed and those proteins that are increasingly carbonylated do not address the same kind of pathways. And just to finish up with that, so we did compare the proteins that we found carbonylated upon the senescence of myoblasts and those that we picked upon acute oxidative stress, and there was quite a reasonable number of proteins that were heated by carbonylation in both situations, about 45 overlapping, which means that in senescence there is something to do probably with this oxidative stress situation and the way they do accumulate. So at this point, I'm done. So I'd like to thank the collaborators, the mass spec people at the University of Odense, Adelina and Peter Robstorff, and our collaborator here in Paris for this muscle progenitor analysis, and obviously the people from my team that who have done the work. Otherwise, I would not be here to talk about it. And I'd like to thank also the support of the different grants we've been in and networks as well. And I'd like to thank you for your attention. But last but not least, so if you really appreciate Paris, I welcome you. I hope I will welcome you together with Josiane and other colleagues, because we are now setting up the program for this meeting in 2014, which will be held in Paris, and this is the meeting of the Society of Free Radical Research, and I'd like to thank you again for your attention, and hopefully see you again in Paris in 2014. Thank you.
Thank you, Bertrand, for this insightful presentation. We have a time for several questions, please.
Yes. An interesting presentation. I was impressed to see how affected is glycolysis. Because many enzymes, some of them regulatory, are now oxidized water. Mm-hmm. But my question goes the other way around. Of the many proteins you've seen, do you know if there are some energy catabolic pathways that are spared? So beta oxidation or ketone body utilization.
Yeah. Yeah, we do have that as well. Yeah, we do have that in the rat liver mitochondria study. We have beta oxidation, which is being targeted as well.
Awesome.
But yeah. So, but we have to go on this functional analysis because you know both the proteomics and the metabolomics are just very descriptive and quite correlative. So it's good to go to the function. So now we're trying to look at that using those old-fashioned metabolic flow analysis, and it's promising. Yeah, so I just alluded to the one we've done with that my postdoc, Martin Baribar has done on the glycolytic pathway, but we are thinking of doing it for the other pathways
so
as well.
That the others are spared, and then we can get energy as we grow old from other sources.
I don't think so. No, I think there might be some compensatory mechanism, so we still need to address that. What is the pathway which is the most affected?
Yeah.
And it might be very different in different organs or in different cell types, as we've seen from this comparison with fibroblasts and myoblasts. Obviously, it's not the same.
Thank you, Bertrand.
Okay, yep, Corinne. Listening.
Thank you, very interesting presentation. My question was also about the glycolytic studies. I was wondering if you managed to identify the location of the modifications in the proteins, because it's always a worry with glycolytic enzymes that what you're seeing is just the ones that are most abundant. If you didn't actually map the modifications. And so, you know, it would be really interesting to know where the modifications.
No, that's true enough. I didn't have time to do that, but yeah, we recently set up a method to look at least at the level of carbonylation in a very quantitative way. So based on the 2D dye. So we expect with this technique to say, okay, we have 50% of the protein being carbonylated. So that's one part of the answer. So the other one would be nice to know whether it does anything to the protein, because even if it's 50% of the protein which is being heated this way, it might not do anything, although it's, I doubt it, but it still has to be confirmed. But well, you're aware of that, we would need more material and more intense experimental work to get at the modification site. So that's why we've been trying to overlook that, looking at metabolic flows. Then we can look at a real full pathway, which avoids to measure the enzyme one by one and analyze them one by one, yeah, which is a bit tedious, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Very nice talk, actually, a very remarkable discipline. I was just wondering if, you know that muscles respond by either differentiation or regeneration upon oxidative stress, and there is a lot of work on histone modifications, obviously, in the mitochondria multiply. But my question was, do you actually see any modification of DNMTs or acetylating enzymes, because in the whole muscle, because obviously your work is on mitochondria specifically.
Although in muscle, actually those are muscle progenitors, those are the satellite cells, so we've not been looking at muscle fibers. And we're trying to address that, whether when we take an old muscle versus a young one, whether we would pick the same kind of protein. And in the muscle, actually in those satellite cells, we didn't see that many proteins in mitochondria. And as far as I recall, we didn't find those proteins. Maybe they're not abundant enough so that we could not pick them. So it should be, you know, looked at directly, the kind of IP, the protein of interest, and see if there is any modification.
Thank you.
Thank you.